हेलो चल स्टार्ट।
हाँ यस सर, यस सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ द पार्टिसिपेंट्स। एज ए थर्ड डे टुडे there are four presentations in the morning two and the afternoon two. In the first in the morning session, in the first speaker, Dr. Satya Sagar Bogila, assistant professor, IIT Jammu, will deliver his expert lecture on research and development of a hydrogen energy system for grid and transportation application. Dr. Satya Sagar Bogila, he has completed his PhD in IIT Guwahati and he has pursued his postdoctoral research in Cape Town, South Africa in 2013 to 2014, and also from Japan University in between 2014 and 2016. His areas of interest are hydrogen energy, renewable energy systems, energy storage, fuel cells, heat transfer, thermodynamics, thermal energy systems, renewable energy systems, and electronics cooling. So he was awarded the Alexander von Humboldt Connect Fellowship by the German government in 2020, which is a prestigious award. He was also selected by the Department of Science and Technology for participating in BRICS Young Scientist Conclave in the area of energy, which was held in Durban, South Africa in 2018. He was awarded the best paper. His paper was awarded for the best paper in the first National Conference in Innovations in Sustainable Energy and Technology, which was held by the Energy Institute, Bangalore. And the award, the paper was awarded in 2020. In fact, he was given a postdoctoral fellowship in the year 2014 to 16 to do it in Japan. He was also awarded another postdoctoral fellowship in the year 2013 and 2014. Dr. Satya is a very enthusiastic researcher in the area of hydrogen. So I welcome Dr. Satya Sagar Bogila for delivering his expert lecture. Over to Dr. Satya.
My slides are visible, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for a kind introduction. And I would like to thank the organizer for giving me this opportunity to talk about research and development of a hydrogen energy system for grid and transport applications. So thanks for being here to listen my talk. So my plan of presentation as follows. First, I'll talk about this present fragile energy economy and related emission trends and environmental problems. Then I will discuss about why hydrogen as a clean energy carrier. Then we'll discuss about various elements of hydrogen energy economy. Then also we'll discuss about the future hydrogen economy. Actually, I want to quote here from Jules Verne. This quote is from 1874. What he told is, water will be the coal of the future. Okay. So it means that that quote is, even though it is 19th century, but it is now very well applicable now. So in future, hydrogen will become the future energy carrier. Now, if you see this various global environmental challenges we have, like we have climate change, air quality, and energy security. So climate change we want to tackle, and we have agreement in Paris 2015, like what the previous speakers discussed about this. We want to decrease that global warming less than 2 degrees compared to pre-industrial levels. Then also we want to regulate the NOx emissions, okay? And if you see the situation in Delhi during your November, December, during winter time, okay? So we have so much air quality problem in some cities. Then now we have present energy security. We want to have like a self-sustainable country, and our PM calls that is Atmanirbhar Bharat, okay? So we want to generate renewable energy, okay? We want to decrease the imports of oil and gas, okay? So that's what we are now investing into, alternate energy technology. So if you see this, all the things, these are actually some challenges you can see, or sometimes you can see the opportunities for automobile vehicles, automobile companies. So basically they have to move from this ICE engine based engines to either battery vehicles or fuel cell vehicles. So now we have a two-step process to phase out these fossil fuels. One is, first we have to phase out of fossil fuel vehicles, then we can go for phase out of fossil fuel power plants. Okay. So this is our present hydrocarbon economy, or you can say present energy system. As you know that you know very well about that fossil fuels combustion, how this is creating problem to the environment, and I think most of the speakers discussed about this, so I'm skipping here. So now if you see our global energy demand, okay, so we started using this biomass from 1850, okay, before that, then slowly we moved from solid to liquid fuels, like we went to go for from coal to oil, okay. Then again we have this standard of living increased in Western countries, so that the energy demand has increased, okay. So we have used so much of oil and coal in that time between 1950 and 2000 for only majority for Western countries. Then from 1990 they have China having rapid industrialization, so their demand also increased. Okay, then after that, if you see, we have increased this renewable energy generation. Okay, so because of this, all the problems. Then if you see here in this graph, there is a 2030, after that, there is a decline in using of fossil fuel energy sources, but even though our demand is increasing. Okay, so this gap is covering by our renewable energy sources. But the problem with renewable energy sources, basically solar is well distributed energy, but in diluted form. To capture the solar energy, we have to have so much infrastructure. As well as the solar and wind are intermittent nature, to supply these energy sources to the grid is not easy. Okay, because you cannot continuously supply the electricity from this solar or wind for the demand from the grid. So you need to have like kind of storage system if you want to supply a constant amount of electricity to the grid, or the grid requirement, if you want to match with this solar and wind energy, it needs some kind of storage system. Or maybe in future, if it's hydrogen will become an energy carrier, then it's very easy. You can supply whatever amount of the energy coming from the solar and wind to the grid, the remaining energy you can use for hydrogen production. Okay, so this will become as a fuel. So then we don't have a big problem by combining this renewable energy sources to the grid, power grid. So here you can see, I'm showing here the energy balance of trade fuels. Okay, basically these are coming from oil, gas, and coal. We'll see like a different years from 1990, 2017, and 2040. 2040 is basically the predicted one. you can see for various regions, the red one is actually it's a deficit, means they are importing these oils and gas. Okay, the blue one is actually they have some surplus. If you see USA, actually in 1990 they are a deficient country, but 2017 they are surplus, 2014 more surplus regarding this oil and gas. Okay, actually they are going big towards renewable energy. Then if you see the European countries always they are in deficient countries, okay, because they don't have any reservoirs much compared to Russia or USA or Middle East countries. Then similar to these Asian countries, basically India, China, these are basically deficient countries. Okay, you have to import oil, gas for our own consumption. Even 2040, we are imported, like we are dependent on imports. Okay, now if you see India imports in 2019, we have around that import amount is around $480 billion. Okay, it's a huge amount of money we are spending on imports for various components. But in this, see, you can see 33% it is coming from the mineral fuels, oils and distillation products. Okay, so majority of money is going to the import of these fuels. Okay, so if you want to reduce this these fuels or all other things, then you have to go for like other like battery vehicles or fuel cell vehicles, and you can also generate the renewable energy. Okay, so that we can decrease these imports, and we can say that we can have like energy self-sustainability. So we can go for our PM call, that is Atmanirbhar Bharat. Okay. Now we can see the projected CO2 reductions from various sources. Basically, these are predictions. Okay. You can see the contribution of CO2 from various sectors. If you see, we want to reduce the CO2 emissions from mileage, it is around 35%. Okay, then energy production, we want to reduce 13% by increasing the efficiencies. Okay, and we are going for a renewable energy production. Then we also want to decrease this CO2 emissions by 30% by using some kind of efficient lighting and efficient air conditioning systems, like 5-star air conditioning systems. Okay, then we have another like renewable energy sources. So based on this, we want to reduce the CO2 emissions, okay, by 2030. If you see, the majority is coming from mileage. So you have to reduce CO2 emissions by 2030 from mileage. It is around 35%. It's very big value. So if you want to reduce this mileage, the transportation CO2 emissions, then you have to move towards either battery vehicles or fuel cell vehicles. So now I'm showing some policies as taken by some countries. Okay, so if you see European Union, they agree to cut around 30% of truck and bus CO2 emissions by 2030. Similar to Norway has taken some policy, they want to ban this combustion engine vehicles from 2025. Okay, then we have like UK, France, they want to ban the sales of ICE engines by 2040. And similarly, you have taken other countries also, they have taken. So these actually creating some opportunities for automobile manufacturers to create zero emission vehicles. Okay, either it's a battery or fuel cell. Then if you see the OEMs green car strategies by various companies, okay, so their preparation is like, you can see that Volkswagen, they want to stop this gasoline and diesel cars in 2026. So you can, I have a quote here from the head of the Volkswagen. What he says that in the year of 2026 will be the last product start on the combustion engine platform. So then they will go for either battery or fuel cell vehicles. Similarly, Hyundai, Toyota, they have some strategies to move towards this zero emission vehicles. Then what is the replacement of oil for the transport sector? We have a natural gas. Okay, it can reduce the CO2 emissions, but it's not a long-term solution. We want to self-sustainable, or you want to reduce the imports, then we should not go more towards natural gas. Then we have another alternative, second generation of biofuels. But these are will impact on field situation if you go for a too much use of land for generating these biofuels. Then impact on environment, like you have to have like some kind of free land, then you have to cut the forest and use up some fertilizers and irrigation problem. Basically, we need water for this. Already we have water scarcity. Then we cannot use water for this creating the fuels. Then we have another option like electrical drives. You can use kind of lithium ion batteries. Then we have another option, hydrogen as a fuel. Okay. So here we have to remember that this hydrogen has to come from non-fossil hydrogen. Means it has to come from renewable energy sources, or we can call as that is green hydrogen. So green hydrogen has to be used as a fuel in the vehicle. So now these are the various R&D steps, okay, to create zero emission vehicle. First, what we are doing is we are using some kind of fuel and economy improvement, means you are increasing efficiency of IC engines. Okay, that is one strategy. Then we are moving towards hybridization. We want to we are having both the vehicle have combustion engine as well as some kind of battery. Then the next step, the ultimate goal is to go for electrification. Either you will use hydrogen based vehicle or you will use battery based vehicle. So that is the last important final step towards this zero emission vehicles. I think this, you know, the difference between the fuel cell and battery, because I think last 2 days the sessions has discussed about this fuel cell basics and the batteries. So I'll give a small introduction here. Basically, you have fuel cell means you will supply, you have to supply the fuel continuously, whereas in battery the chemicals stored inside the battery system already there. But battery, you cannot give the electricity like continuously. But fuel cell, if you continuously supply the fuel, then it can generate electricity. That is the main difference between the fuel cell and battery. So I think the fuel cell basics already discussed by I think Dr. Rajalakshmi and Dr. Vidya and Dr. Vasu. Okay, so basically fuel cell will convert the chemical energy into electricity, and it is having a very high efficiency compared to IC engines, low noise and stable power generation, and we can reduce the expensive power transmission and less pollution. So here hydrogen will come to the anode and it will break into proton and electron. Okay, the proton will transfer from the membrane, and cathode side it will mix with the oxygen and the electron. So basically it will form as a water vapor. So here we have two types of output. One is your electricity, second is heat, because this reaction is exothermic reaction. So it will generate heat as well as electricity. Now now you should know that if you want to go for zero emission vehicles, either we can go for battery or fuel cell. So which one you have to go? So we have two options. Obviously, present trend now more towards battery. Okay, but the battery, the limitations are if you have like if you want to go within the city, like daily you want to go for 100 kilometers, then the battery vehicle is the best one compared to fuel cell. But if you compare like if you have like some trucks and all, not small vehicles, you have big trucks and all, then these vehicles will go like 500 kilometers per day or 1,000 kilometers. Okay, so these kind of vehicles, you cannot use batteries. Okay, because if you see your energy storage system volume will increase drastically with if you increase the your mileage. Like if you want to range like 150 miles or 100 miles, you can see how much volume is taking. Means if you want to carry for a big truck these batteries, then you have to connect one more truck to carry the batteries. Then another disadvantage is for batteries, the refilling time. So maybe for 100 kilometers, 200 kilometers, you can go for 1 hour filling. But if you want to go for like 1,000 kilometers or 500 miles, then you need like 3-4 hours for charging. Whereas if you go for hydrogen based vehicles, then you can recharge within 5 minutes. Okay, so that is the advantage of fuel cell. And as I told, the batteries vehicles are good. If you go for within the city, like Delhi, if you go for 50 to 100 kilometers, then obviously battery vehicles are much more advanced compared to fuel cell vehicles at this point. Okay, because battery vehicles already started manufacturing, so many companies are there. So once you started manufacturing, if you have so many companies, obviously the cost will come down. Okay, so that is not case in hydrogen based vehicles. Maybe in future by 2030, so the same situation will come for fuel cell vehicles. And also government is giving this lot of subsidy for batteries. I think they have increased recently from 10% to 15% subsidy for the battery vehicles. Now, then why hydrogen deserves attention? If you see this system means our history about these various fuels. First, we started with solid, then we use it in liquid. Now we have moved to gases. It's like we are started from solids to gases, now moved towards gases. Why if you want to have use hydrogen as a fuel? Because hydrogen is the smallest of all the atoms and it is having high energy content. Like almost it is having 3 times than that of gasoline per kg of the fuel. Okay, that much high energy content is having. But the disadvantage is it is having very low energy density per unit volume. So it required large storage tanks, or you have to go for either compressor based systems or some kind of other like solid sorption systems. So if you see the total hydrogen energy system from production to usage, you can see we started in future we'll have like either production from renewable energy, or we can use nuclear power plants to generate the hydrogen. Okay, so this will be the green hydrogen. So once you produce the hydrogen from various sources, then you can use in transport applications and residential applications by using combustion or commercial buildings or industries. Okay, again it will become water at the end of the cycle. Now this will be the your world hydrogen economy. This is what this scientist want. Like you want to generate hydrogen by using renewable energy sources and nuclear energy, and that hydrogen will be used for transport applications. Okay, by combusting, either combustion or you can use fuel cell vehicles. Then you can get the useful amount of energy. So you can, here you can see the cycle will be complete. So we are taking a H2O water to generate hydrogen. Again, if you go for combustion or fuel cell, then you are getting the hydrogen back. Okay. Similarly, you have a oxygen also similar in cyclic manner. Now you can see for hydrogen fuel vehicle, what are the elements we have? You can see here the first one is you have a hydrogen storage system. Obviously, you have to store the hydrogen to keep continuously supply the hydrogen to the fuel cell to generate the electricity. And we have a fuel cell module, and we have a motor to convert into mechanical energy, and we have some kind of battery system. Okay, so battery is basically this small capacity, but it will have like it will fluctuate this energy from the fuel cells. Okay, it will absorb and it will can give the constant amount of power to the motor. So, and also starting time, you need some kind of energy so that we can take from the battery. So now you have seen, I think previous speakers explained about various fuel cells, types of fuel cells. So basically these fuel cells can be distinguished by temperature limits, like low temperature fuel cells and high temperature fuel cells. Basically, we are using like PEM fuel cells for transport applications. Okay, because these are quick to start. Okay, easy maintenance. Then now the recent advancement towards related to solid oxide fuel cells. Basically, these are you can use for like a small power plants. Here we can get the both heat and power. Basically, these are combined heat and power applications, like CHP applications. So here you can see the PEM fuel cell brief history. So when it started, the conception in 1839, that is given by Sir William Groom, that is demonstrated the fuel cell operating principle. Then again reinvented by Francis Bacon, started working on tactical fuel cells in 1937. So by the end of the 1950, he was able to develop 6 kilowatt cell. Okay, that is huge development that time. Then first application, practical applications, we use it for like a this Gemini program in for NASA. Then they started a first vehicle application by General Motors. Okay, so they have experimented with the fuel cell power van. Okay, in mid-1960s. Then it was re-entry by Perry Energy Systems, and Ballard demonstrated the PEM powered submarine. So Ballard is one of the pioneer to manufacturing these fuel cells. I think these fundamentals already explained by previous speakers. I'm speaking here. So here you can see the maximum efficiency of the system. If you consider about ideal case, efficiency we can go for like if you use higher heating value 83% and lower heating value 94%. Okay, but you may have doubt why these efficiencies are more than our Carnot efficiencies. Okay, basically there is a Carnot efficiency myth here. PFC is not a heat engine, but it's a electrochemical engine. So you cannot apply the Carnot efficiency limit. So that's why these engines, pump fuel cells, are very high efficient compared to our ICE engines. So these are the various components. I think already you know, I'm skipping here. Then we'll see hydrogen production, like various technologies we have. First one is we have steam reforming of natural gas. Then we have partial oxidation of heavy hydrocarbons. Then we have partial oxidation of coal, then we have electrolysis. Okay, so if you want to have like a green hydrogen, then you can use either electrolysis or you can use some kind of thermochemical method to use, either you can use nuclear energy or you can use solar energy, okay, to split the water into hydrogen and oxygen. So in this case, your electrolysis and the thermochemical method and photosynthesis, these are basically you can create kind of green hydrogen, but the cost at present is very high compared to other methods. But once if you manufacture more amount of that electrolyzers, then the cost may come down, because already the solar cost per kilowatt hour, it is coming down to like, I think nowadays we can see like tender cost 1.5 rupees or 2 rupees. Similar way, already that energy input cost is decreased, then if you electrolyzer cost also decreases, then the production cost also will decrease. Then once you produce hydrogen, then you have to store the hydrogen. Then what are the options available for hydrogen storage? So here we have like high pressure gas cylinders and liquid hydrogen cryogenic tanks, and we have metal hydrates, the liquid chemicals, porous materials, carbon nanomaterials, and various other materials to store the hydrogen. Now we'll see one by one how we can use, what are the limitations of these options. So if you see the conventional methods, we can have like high pressure gas cylinders, because I explained that hydrogen having very less density, low density. Okay, then if you want to increase the density to have like less volume for the transport sector, then obviously you have to compress the hydrogen. So you can compress the hydrogen from like 200 bar to 800 bar. We have various cylinders, okay, composite cylinders available to store the hydrogen at this pressure. Here, obviously, when you are comparing compressing, the volume and density increases with storage pressure, and obviously you have a low gravimetric density. And but the problem here, it is unsafe. You are carrying a like 800 bar cylinder with you always in the like vehicle. Something happened to your vehicle, then it may be create some problem. Then another method. here we have one more problem from this compressor cylinders. Basically, if you want to compress the hydrogen from like 10 bar to like a 300 bar or 400 bar, you need to spend a lot of energy. Suppose you consider like compression from 10 bar to 400 bar, it is requires around 18% of the hydrogen energy. Like you are compressing 1 kg of hydrogen from 10 bar to 400 bar, it will take whatever that amount of energy is there in the hydrogen, that 1 kg, 18% is required to compress. Means already you lost 18% of energy. Then we have another option like liquid hydrogen. You know, liquid hydrogen can be liquefied at 20 kilovolt at ambient pressure. Okay. But the problem here, even though you have like high insulating tanks, but the leak will be there. Okay. So this will create some boil off process. So we should leave this gases based hydrogen to the atmosphere. Otherwise, the pressure will increase. Okay. So here we have a boil off process. Then another problem here, we need to liquefy hydrogen about 35% of energy contained in the hydrogen. So whatever, if you liquefy 1 kg of hydrogen, then for liquefying itself, you will take 35% of energy in the content in the hydrogen. Means remaining we will have only 65%. Okay, this is huge amount. So we cannot use this method for storing hydrogen for onboard applications. You can see, you can compare various storage media for hydrogen with the metal hydrates, like that is solid sorption materials to store the hydrogen. Then we have a compressed hydrogen and liquid hydrogen. If you see, compared with the liquid hydrogen and compressed hydrogen, this metal hydrates can store the grams of hydrogen stored per liter volume will be more compared to compressed and liquid hydrogen. You can also here see the comparison various options, like if you go for a hydrogen to compression 200 bar, that will be this much tank is required. Then if you go for liquefied option, then this much tank is required. Whether if you go out to go for another materials like lanthanum or magnesium, the storage tanks volume is decreasing. Now the DOEs have set the some targets for this hydrogen storage for automobile vehicles. They need kind of like to have target around 5-8%. Okay, capacity. Then operating temperature will be from minus 20 to 50 degrees. Okay, so that is the operating temperature of the your tank to deliver the hydrogen. Then refilling time will be like 0.5 kg per minute, the rate of refilling, that is the our target. Then delivery pressure should be above 2.5 bar because you have to supply to the fuel cell this whatever the hydrogen is generated from your tank. So these are the targets set by the Department of Energy, ESE. Now we have seen the various options for hydrogen storage. One is compressed hydrogen, liquid hydrogen, and second is metal hydrates. So if we see this metal hydrates, basically these are intermetal compounds, okay, forming alloying for different materials by either ball milling or melting. If you have like a metal hydrate and if you have hydrogen, will absorb, then it will create a metal hydrate plus heat. Basically this absorption is exothermic, whereas whenever you need the hydrogen from this metal hydrate, okay, just you supply the heat, okay, it will dissolve the hydrogen. Basically it is a endothermic reaction. We can call these two reactions heat driven mass transfer phenomena, because if you want to have like absorption rate is more, then we have to take the heat from the metal hydrate is very fast. Otherwise, the pressure will increase and you will have a less the reaction kinetics. Then the desorption, similar way, if you want to have like more hydrogen, like desorption rate is high, then you have to supply the heat in faster way. Okay, so this metal hydrates can absorb and dissolve hydrogen at various pressures and temperatures. So this various applications of metal hydrates, you can see here, we can use for either hydrogen storage or compressor or refrigerator and heat pump and heat transformer. basically we can play with this heat and mass transfer phenomena, okay, and we can construct some kind of like thermal engines, like heat pump, heat transformer, or refrigerator. Okay. Other than this hydrogen storage and hydrogen compressor applications. So these are the basic reactions in the absorption and desorption. Basically, in absorption, we have a physics option, then we have a chemist option, then surface penetration and diffusion and nucleation growth. These are the various steps for the hydrogen absorption in the metal hydride. Whereas the desorption is opposite way, okay, just it will go in reverse way. So, what are the advantages of metal hydrides for hydrogen storage application? So, it can store hydrogen at room temperature and atmospheric pressure compared to your compressor hydrogen or liquid hydrogen options. Okay. Then we have high storage capacities, ability to absorb, release large amount of hydrogen gas many times without getting any deterioration. Then we have you can control the absorption, desorption. You can control either by adjusting the temperature or pressure, because as I told, these are heat and mass transfer phenomena. Then these are basically environmental friendly. You can use these metal hydride based thermal machines for using various low grade energy inputs. I will explain later how we can use the low grade thermal energy for use this kind of machines. Then we have this kind of safety storage, because you are absorbing at maybe atmosphere to 20 bar, then it's very safe for mobile applications. So you can use can go for around 15,000 cycles without having any problem. So here you can see the your hydrogen absorption. So this is the PCT curve. It will show the pressure, concentration and temperature. You can see that the absorption at different temperatures, like 0 degrees, 25 degrees and 100 degrees centigrade. So these are the applications of the metal hydrides for hydrogen storage, compressor, refrigerator, thermal energy storage system. So now I'll explain about my experience of this golf cart. Okay, so we have replaced the battery in golf cart, and we have given this metal hydride cylinder plus fuel cells. So here you can see the developed hydrogen storage tank for this golf cart application. So you can see in this schematic, this one is your stainless steel container, and the second is your heat exchanger, because metal hydrides are very low thermal conductivity, okay, like 0.5 or 0.3. So in that case, as I told, this absorption, desorption, or heat and mass transfer phenomena, if you want to desorb hydrogen in a faster way, then you have to supply the heat in fast way. So you want to enhance the heat transfer, so you use some kind of fins, okay, to increase the thermal conductivity inside the tank. Then we can see this third is your hydrogen manifold, and 3.1 is your filter. Okay, and we have a over pressure production. Then we have a water manifold inlet and outlet, because when you want to desorb hydrogen, you have to supply the heat through the water, or when it's absorption, you have to remove the heat, because it's a exothermic reaction. Okay, so that heat has to remove, otherwise the pressure will increase, so the absorption may stop. So you have to continuously remove the heat when it is in absorption, or in desorption, you have to continuously supply heat, the endothermic heat required for the desorption of hydrogen from the metal hydride container. So this is our design container for hydrogen storage for the mobile application. Then what we have done is we have integrated this metal hydride system with the PEM fuels in electric golf cart system. You can see here. Okay, so this is our fuel cell, and this is your metal hydride storage tank backside of your golf cart. Okay. I think similar system yesterday as shown by Dr. Vasu in BHL. Now here you can see the various parts in the this combined system. So first one is your metal hydride container. The second one is you have a compressor based buffer cylinder, like we can store about 150 bar compressed hydrogen here. I will explain why we need this kind of buffer cylinder, okay, for this metal hydride and fuel cell combination. Then we have a third is your pressure reducer, because it is containing around 180 bar and 150 bar pressure. You have to reduce the pressure before supplying to the your fuel cell. Then the fourth one is the recharge valve. Okay, so whenever your hydrogen is over in this both metal hydride tank and buffer cylinder, you have to recharge again by using this valve. Then fifth is your heat exchanger of the metal hydride container, because as I told, we have to supply the heat when you want to dissolve the hydrogen, and you have to remove the heat when it is absorbing. Then 6 and 10, your air liquid heat exchangers. Okay, so these are the your heat exchangers, and 11th is your fuel cell tank. Here you can see we have thermal integrated this fuel cell and metal hydride tank, because as I explained, when your fuel cell is generating the electricity, it will also generate some kind of heat. Okay, so that heat we will use to dissolve the hydrogen from the metal hydride. So the desorption from the metal hydrides is like endothermic reaction, so you have to supply heat, as well as at the same time you are supplying to the hydrogen to the fuel cell, it is also generating heat plus electricity. So the generated heat can be supplied to metal hydride, okay, so that we can integrate, thermally integrate this fuel cell and metal hydride without giving energy from the outside. So this is our basic concept for this golf cart. Then we have tested the our integrated system on the golf cart. Like we have tested without using the buffer cylinder, initially with only supplying from metal hydride. So you can see here the system is run around 1 hour without having any problem. Okay, but it was stuck after 1 hour because your pressure is decreases. Okay, in the metal hydride, I will explain why the pressure is decreased, because as I explained, this metal hydrides have very low thermal conductivity. Okay, so this whatever this generated heat is not able to heat the metal hydride. It means that to dissolve the hydrogen, the metal hydride taking heat from metal hydride itself. Okay, it means that the temperature decreases metal hydride inside the tank. Then if the temperature decreases, the pressure also decreases. So once the pressure is going down below 2.2 bar or 2.5 bar, then the fuel cell will stop functioning. Okay, so this is main because of the initial heat supply rate is low, because you have to generate the fuel cell heat, and that heat has to integrate to the metal hydride tank. So because of this, the low amount of heat supply, the metal hydride cools itself and the temperature decreases and the pressure also decreases. Because of that, the fuel cell stopped after like 55 minutes or 60 minutes, even though we have that hydrogen inside the metal hydride to generate, but because of this low pressure, the fuel cell is stopped. Later, what we have done is we added some kind of the buffer cylinder. So I have shown in the previous picture. So now you can see how the fuel cell run over around 2 hours without having any problem, because here you have to remember that the hydrogen is come from two sources. One is metal hydride tank, and second is your buffer cylinder. Because the hydrogen is coming from both sources, the supply from the metal hydride is less compared to previous case. Then obviously the heat requirement for the endothermic reaction also decreases, because it's depend upon the how much amount of hydrogen you have dissolved from the tank. So once it is the heat rate is decreased, your input rate is decreased, then the temperature of the metal hydride tank will not come down. So obviously you can maintain the pressure. Once if the temperature is inside the tank, then the pressure also will be above atmospheric pressure. Then it can continuously supply the hydrogen without having any problem for the fuel cell. So then fuel cell will generate both heat as well as electricity. So that electricity will be used to run the vehicle. Okay, so this is the advantage if you use a buffer cylinder at initial time, because initial time only you will have some problem with the heat supply to the metal hydride tank. Here you can see the combined hydrogen storage system for this golf cart. You can see how the flow rate with respect to time, almost we run around 5 hours continuously with using these both the storage options without having any problem. If you see individually, either if you use metal hydrates around, it will be like 60 to 90 minutes, it will stop. Even with compressed hydrogen also, it can stop around 90 minutes. But if you combine both these systems, then you can increase this, the mileage coming from the fuel cell system. So up to like 5 hours, you can go without having any problem. This is just test this integrated system for golf cart. If you have like a bigger systems, then it can go like 10 hours or 15 hours. It's not a problem. Okay. So this is 5 hours limit is not applicable for other systems. Then you can see here. If you see here, you can see that as I told, that problem coming from the metal hydride storage tank to deliver the hydrogen, the heat supply. You can see initially the most of the hydrogen is supplied by the compressor hydrogen. Okay, so because of this, you have less requirement of heat from the to the metal hydride, so that once the fuel cell generates started supplying the heat, you can also supply it to the metal hydride tank, so that you can maintain required temperature and pressure inside the metal hydride, so that it can supply continuous amount of hydrogen over the tank. Okay, so this is the both buffer storage and this is metal hydride storage tank. Now you see, we have developed this hydro storage tank and fuel cell for onboard applications. Now you want to develop some kind of hydrogen refueling station. Usually people use to compress by using mechanical compressors to compress the hydrogen for refueling application, because if you want to refill this hydrogen to your hydrogen vehicles, then you need some kind of refueling station. Okay, means if you go for like high pressure compressor cylinders, then you have to refuel at the pressure of around 350 bar or 400 bar or 700 bar, depend upon your storage tanker pressure limit. Now the problem with the mechanical compressors, it will use high grade energy, but electricity, and also safety is the problem to compress the hydrogen. Okay, then we can use this kind of compressor, metal hydride based compressor, thermal driven metal hydride based compressor to compress the hydrogen by using some kind of low grade heat or waste heat from the industry. Okay, just use your the waste heat or low grade heat from the industry. Okay, that you can supply to the metal hydride system to drive the compression application. Okay. So we have developed like 3-stage hydrogen compressor. It can compress from 3 bar to 200 bar up to like the flow rate can be like 5 Newton meter per hour. Here you can see we have taken like 3 cylinders. Like we will compress in step by step. First stage will compress from like 3 to 20 bar by using this kind of materials. Then you can compress the second stage 20 bar to 50 bar by using this kind of materials. Okay, because these materials requirement will be depend upon your pressure limits and temperature limits. Okay, so now the third stage will come from 50 bar to 200 bar by using this kind of NI. Okay, so with this system, by using this waste heat like 140, 120 degrees centigrade, so you can compress the hydrogen from 3 bar to 200 bar without using any your high grade energy. So that is the advantage of this metal hydride based hydrogen compressor. Because the same PCD curves we are using, we are tiling to make the match the requirements of your refilling station. So this is the one of the applications of metal hydrates, like previously like hydrogen storage we have seen. So these are the metal hydrates for various applications. You can see. Then we can see the various fuel cell buses developed by different automobile manufacturers. Now coming into this our global potential of various energy sources. If you see, our world consumption is just now 18.5 terawatt. But if we compare the availability of solar, it is much more higher. But the problem is that solar is well distributed, but it is in diffused way. Okay, to collect the solar energy, it is difficult task. Okay, similarly, we have wind energy availability is around 75 to 130 terawatt. Okay, so but these two sources are intermittent sources. Okay, so if you want to connect these sources to the grid, then we need kind of some kind of storage system. Like sometimes your energy source supply is more compared to demand, or sometimes your demand is more compared to your supply. Suppose you say you take evening 6 to 9 or 6 to 10, then in that case your demand is more compared to other time. Then in that case, we need some kind of storage system. It can store the excess amount of energy from the grid. It means that your supply is more than demand. Then in that case, the storage system has to store the energy. Then another case, whenever your demand is more than supply, okay, this system has to supply energy to the grid. Okay, basically the grid has the it has to control the grid for demand as well as supply. So we have started the research on this kind of energy storage system for grid applications. Basically, the problem with this integrating renewable energy into future electricity system like power grid, then you have to control the load leveling and fluctuation absorption, because the every time this renewable energy is intermittent, it will change with respect to the time, depend upon the availability of wind power and availability of solar irradiation. Okay, so in this case we have created some concept of this totalized hydrogen energy blend system. Here you can see we have energy coming from the grid, okay, and it is supplying to the demand. So whenever you have a more supply than demand, then the excess power we can take to supply to the electrolyzer. So electrolyzer can produce hydrogen that can be stored into the storage tank. Then in next time your demand is more coming from the grid than compared to supply. In that case, this system can generate power by taking the hydrogen, by using the hydrogen stored in the metal hydride tank. So that can supply to the fuel cell and it can generate the electricity as well as heat. Okay, and because we are talking about this hydrogen based vehicles in future, so this hydrogen storage also we can use to supply hydrogen to the refueling stations. You can take this hydrogen and supply to the hydrogen refueling stations. Basically, this system can supply, okay, electricity, hydrogen as well as thermal energy. Okay, just you are taking the excess power from the grid whenever you have more power availability compared to your demand. Then after that, it can deliver whenever you need the power. At the same time, it can also deliver hydrogen as well as thermal energy. So this system can act as a energy storage system for renewable energy. So here you can see this unitized reversible fuel cell, and I think most of the speakers talked about electrolyzer and fuel cell. Okay, now this unitized reversible fuel cell is, it is a combination of both. It can work as a fuel cell or it can work as a electrolyzer. Okay, now we can see this hydrogen storage tank, and here you can see the inner view of the UFC. We have a UFC stack and a DC load for a fuel cell application and DC power supply for an electrolyzer application. We have a chiller, okay, to supply this cold fluid and to extract the amount of energy from this stack. Here we have used kind of like 10 cells. So each cell will have like 250 centimeters square, and you can see that in electrolyzer operation, it can take 4.4 kilowatt as input, and fuel cell mode, it can generate around 680 watts. Okay, so here we are using the metal hydride tank for like for hydrogen storage application. So, and it will be integrated with the UFC. So these are the various materials used for the UFC stack. I think this already covered by the previous speakers. Okay, And these are the various flow field and various components of the UFC, like balance of plant, we can say. So here, in fuel cell mode, we'll supply hydrogen to the anode side, okay, and cathode side, you will get the water vapor. Okay. And as I told, the fuel cell will generate heat. So that heat we are taking with respect to the heat management system. Okay. So we have some kind of pump and we have kind of some chiller. So it can supply constant temperature fluid and it will take the heat from the fuel cell and it can take back. Okay. So in this way, we are doing the thermal management for the fuel cell. Again, we have like a water separate tank and oxygen separate tank. We have some kind of pumps for water in electrolyzer operation and water purifier and membrane humidifier to supply this humidifier air. So these are the various components for the UFC. Then what is the advantage of UFC compared to individual systems? So basically it can work both electrolyzer operation and fuel cell mode of operation. It can bring down capital cost, because if you buy individual systems, then the capital cost will be more compared to single system. And higher operating ratio per one device means, you see, you can understand that in this storage option, you will not use electrolyzer and fuel cell at the same time. So either one, you can use either electrolyzer operation mode or fuel cell mode. So if you use your UFC, so that it can work any mode and the operating hours, usage hours will be higher compared to individual systems. And we have a less maintenance parts because we are using the same plant for both operations. So you can reduce the footprint of the total system. Now coming to hydrogen storage, again, as explained, we have three different options, the main options. Compressor form, again, the energy requirement from the compression, and liquid form, again, the energy requirement from the liquid by hydrogen. So these two are not useful here in this case. Then we have another option like solid state we can use, because you can store easily at ambient pressure and temperature. And even though it is having a low gravimetric density, but in storage option, like energy storage option, you don't have problem with this weight. Okay, for mobile applications, the maybe this weight is the problem, but in storage options, like standalone storage options, this weight will not create any problem. So again, we have developed this metallite storage tank, okay, to store the hydrogen. So here we have used kind of double coil heat exchanger to enhance the heat transfer within the inside the tank. Okay, so this is the metal hydride we used, around 50 kg of metal hydride. Okay, total weight will be 85 kg with container. Now we have a UFC and we have a hydrogen storage tank. Now we have tested this system for sunny day. Okay, in sunny day you can see the solar radiance will increase up to afternoon and after that decrease. Similar way, the solar energy coming from PV cells also increase and after that decreases. Okay, so in similar way, the power is supplied to the electrolyzer. Okay, so like we have integrated this like PV cells energy, generated energy to the electrolyzer. You can see the power input versus time. So we have run the around 10 hours of the electrolyzer. And you can see the corresponding hydrogen generation from the electrolyzer. You can see both are having same pattern. Okay. Then after this 10 hours, what we are doing is now the solar energy supply is stopped. Okay, because only it can generate daytime. Okay, then it stopped. After that, what we have done is we have used the stored hydrogen in this metal hydride. Okay, when this electrolyzer is operating, and means it is generating hydrogen, the stored hydrogen will be supplied now to the fuel cell. Means that now UFC will work in another mode, that is fuel cell. So we have supplied the hydrogen from the storage tank to the fuel cell and it generated the power. You can see the corresponding power, okay, from the fuel cell. So here we have operated around 14 hours. Okay, because this is 10 hours and this is 14 hours, total complete 24 hours. And you can see the result from the your medal item. So as I explained that in absorption that pressure will increase because it's absorbing the hydrogen, the concentration will increase at the same time, pressure also will increase as per the PCT curve. This option again the pressure will decrease with respect to the concentration. Once you removing the hydrogen, the pressure will decrease. And here you can see the temperature at various locations in the metallurgical storage tank. So you can see if you increase this hydrogen storage, means hydrogen supply, the temperature also increases because the exothermic heat is directly proportional to how much amount of hydrogen is absorbing. Okay, so then in that case, the heat removal rate may not increase because we are supplying constant amount of heat, the fluid. Okay, so the inside the heat will increase, at the same time the temperature also will increase. So you can see this is your input temperature, inlet temperature to the metallurgical storage tank, the fluid, and this is the outlet fluid temperature. So this area will give the amount of heat it is recovered from the metal hydrate. This heat is coming from the exothermic reaction. Now, in a similar way, we have tested for fuel cell around 14 hours. You can see here, as I told, this hydrogen desorption is endothermic reaction. So obviously, the metal hydrate takes heat from metal itself. Okay, so that's why the temperature will decrease. After that, the supply of heat from the outside, it will started, then it will have like almost constant with low slope. So you can see this is your input temperature to the tank and this is the outlet temperature of the tank. You can observe this is around 7 degrees. Okay, it means that this heat you can use for like air conditioning applications because this is the cold energy. Okay, you can that the temperature of the fluid will be around 7 degrees. So this we can use for air conditioning applications, this cold energy. So these are the various performance parameters to find out the efficiency of total system, UFC. Okay. Now we can see the schematic of energy flow from the input to the electrolyzer and output from the fuel cell. So initially we have supplied the electrical energy to the electrolyzer and we have generated the hydrogen. We have some heat loss. Now in fuel cell operation, we have used this stored hydrogen and to generated electrical energy, and some electrical energy we used to for balance of plants like pumps and all. Then we have recovered some kind of heat from the fuel cell and some will be lost. So basically you are getting output electrical energy and some thermal energy, and also we can also use this hydrogen for hydrogen transport application. So this is the energy flow from input to the output. These are the performance data based on the sunny day. So we have around 83% of electrolyzer and 24% of fuel cell, and total will be 51%, means round efficiency of the ERSF will be around 51%. If you include the heat availability from metal hydrate, it can go up to 62%. Now you see, every day will not be like a sunny day, so we have some fluctuations in the solar irradiance and also the fluctuations in the solar power coming from the your PV cells. So obviously it has to match the your electrolyzer, means it has to supply the fluctuations in the power, it has to adjust with respect to the flow rate. Okay, so you can see here your power supply afternoon, particularly afternoon is partly cloudy, so you have some fluctuations in the power supply. You can also see the hydrogen production from the electrolyzer. Okay, you can see similar kind of flow rate, means coming from the hydrogen dust. The pattern is similar. It means that the electrolyzer is cope up with the your fluctuation in the power without having any problem. So so we have generated the hydrogen with this fluctuating power. Okay, up to 10 hours. The same again, we used fuel cell in for electricity generation, the stored hydrogen will be supplied to the fuel cell. Okay, again you can see the same pattern like your hydrogen generation, because this heat at temperature are directly proportional to your amount of hydrogen production. Okay, because this the exothermic heat is directly depend upon the how much of hydrogen it is absorbed in the metallurgical tank. So that so this fluctuations in the temperature and fluctuations in the energy production. These are the various performance parameters. Okay, for this combined system for party cloudy day. You can see you can observe fully sunny day and party cloudy day. Okay, so both efficiency is almost same, means the fluctuations effect is not there on the electrolyzer side. Okay, then you can see the fuel cell efficiency is around 22% and including heat output is around 48%, because if you see the round trip efficiency is around 49% and include this UFC efficiency is around 62%. Okay, maybe you can understand why the difference between the electrolyzer and the fuel cell operation efficiency, because this is due to the power potential difference. Okay, and mainly this UFC is designed for electrolyzer operation mode compared to fuel cell operation. We also means we have given much importance to electrolyzer operation compared to fuel cell operation. So till now we have discussed about the PEM based fuel cells, but PEM based fuel cells, what is the disadvantage is you have a waste heat that will be like 60 degrees and 70 degrees. Somehow if you use high temperature fuel cells, you will get around 100 degrees centigrade. But this heat will not be used for many applications. Okay, so maybe for power plants, the small power plants, PEM may not be useful, but you can use for transport applications. In that case, if you go for a solid oxide fuel cell, okay, so this fuel cell can generate the heat output, the waste heat at 600 degrees centigrade. So if you have like 600 degrees centigrade heat, obviously it can be used for many applications. Even you can generate the some kind of high grade energy from this waste heat. Like you can use, you can integrate solid oxide fuel cell and a gas turbine power plant, or you can use Rankine cycle integrated with the solid oxide fuel cell. So many studies have done so for the integration of solid oxide fuel cell and your gas turbine cycle or Rankine cycle. Or sometimes you can use both this Rankine cycle and Brayton cycle. Like your Rankine cycle will be bottom cycle of the Brayton cycle. Then this Brayton cycle is supplied from the heat from the SOFC. Okay, so in this we have so many combinations. We can integrate this solid oxide fuel cell and other conventional power plants so that we can increase the efficiency of the total plant. Suppose if you go for if you have solid oxide fuel cell efficiency is around 40 to 50% in electrical mode, but if you use the waste heat, still you can improve like 20%, 15 to 20% of efficiency by integrating with other cycles. So here if you see I have shown the solid oxide fuel cell integrated with the metallurgical storage tank and it is integrated with the ORC Rankine cycle and also integrated with the vapor absorption cycle. So you can see in solid oxide fuel cell it will generate the heat. The heat will be supplied to some part of heat will be supplied to metallurgical storage tank to dissolve the hydrogen. So that hydrogen will be supplied to the solid oxide fuel cell. Okay. Solid oxide fuel cells, like it can take like pure hydrogen, or it can also take some kind of methane or other gases. Like they can do internal reforming and they can generate the electricity and waste heat. So in this case, suppose you consider this hydrogen as an input to the solid oxide fuel cell. Okay, now you are generating some kind of waste heat. So that part of the waste heat we are using to generating the hydrogen from the metallurgical storage tank, that generated hydrogen will be supplied to the solid oxide fuel cell. So this will continue, and the remaining the waste heat at 600 degrees centigrade that can supply to some heat exchanger, okay, which can be act as a boiler for organic Rankine cycle. I think this many of you know about organic Rankine cycle. So here we are not using water as a working fluid, we are using some kind of organic fluid like suppose you can take an octane. So this will be like as a boiler, and it will generate the vapor, and this it will go to turbine, and it can generate the mechanical power. After that, it will go to some kind of heat exchanger at high temperature. Then we can remove some kind of heat for heating applications, and after that it can go to this condenser. Okay, this is also at high temperature, around 150 degrees centigrade. So here also we can use this heat for vapor absorption cycle to generate cooling. Then it will go to the pump, again it will go to the heat exchanger. Okay, so here we can have like trigeneration system. We can generate the power from the SOFC, and we can also generate the thermal energy for heating as well as cooling. Okay, so this will work as a for cooling outlet, and this will work as a heating outlet. Suppose you consider Delhi or Jammu, these places both we need in winter, you need heating, as well as in summer we need air conditioning. So this kind of system, if you have, then you can generate electricity, and you can also generate the heat, the space heating, and you can also use this for like air conditioning applications. Okay, if you use like compared to the single SOFC alone, then in efficiency you may get 50%, but you integrate with this other applications, then you can improve the efficiency around 20 to 25%. Okay, compared to individual solid oxide fuel cell. Okay, so this is one system. We can integrate this metal hydride storage tank and the solid oxide fuel cell, and we have a organic Rankine cycle, and we have vapor absorption refrigeration system. Because vapor absorption system, we don't need any high grade energy, maybe little bit power for the pump, but remaining the energy we can supply for the waste heat. Okay, suppose we have like 100 to 150 degree centigrade waste heat coming from this condenser, then that can be supplied to the vapor absorption system, because this is vapor absorption system is basically thermally driven refrigeration cycle, so that it can be used for like air conditioning applications, and this can be used for space heating applications, and you can have the electrical output from this organic Rankine cycle as well as solid oxide fuel cell, so that we can improve the efficiency. Okay, I think next session is going to take by Professor Basu. He will explain more about the solid oxide fuel cell, the main components, and what are the applications. Okay, just I'm giving some brief idea about how we can combine this SOFC with other cycles. Now there is another cycle, same thing, you can use the solid oxide fuel cell. Here we are not using hydrogen as input, but we are using as a methane as input. So this methane will go to here, and it will combine with water, then again it will become carbon monoxide, then again it will go to water, then it will become carbon dioxide, and it will generate hydrogen. Okay, the internal reforming will be there for this kind of systems. Then this SOFC will convert this hydrogen into, again we have a heat as well as electricity. So that heat will be supplied to the your ORC. Okay, so we can generate the power from the waste heat. Again, that again there's some waste heat from the condenser we can use for like your vapor absorption cycle. Okay, so this is the we can say this is a desorber or generator in vapor absorption cycle. So this is thermally driven vapor absorption system for air conditioning applications or cooling applications. So here we are not supplying hydrogen as a fuel, but here we are supplying as a this is methane. Okay, so if you use methane instead of direct combustion, if you use these solid oxide fuels and other systems, then we can improve the efficiency, so that we can decrease the CO2 emissions compared to conventional systems, because the efficiency is more, then obviously you need a less amount of input fuel. Okay, then obviously your CO2 emissions will come down, but still here you will have some CO2 emissions, but this CO2 you can go for like carbon capture and storage, then we can reduce the emissions if you go use like methane as a input supply, whereas in another cycle if you use hydrogen, okay, in this cycle that hydrogen is coming from the electrolyzer. So entirely this is entirely green system, no CO2 emissions. Like if your energy is coming from renewable energy, that is converted into either thermochemical splitting or by using electrolyzer, you can generate that green hydrogen that can be supplied to the SOFC. Obviously, this will give the better efficiency without having any pollution or CO2 emissions. And this one is another system scheme for the ROFC to use like a cogeneration plant. So as I told, you can have like ROFC, that reversible SOFC here. Okay, like as I shown that reversible, like iridated reversible fuel cell for PEM application, here you can see they have used reversible solid oxide fuel cell. Okay, so here, like similar way, this can work as a electrolyzer, this can work as a fuel cell. Suppose you have power from the fuel PV, that is excess compared to grid, that the excess power you can go for this energy controller, that will go to the electrolyzer, that can supply generate hydrogen, that will go to the hydrogen storage cylinder. Okay, then it can generate some kind of heat that can be used for the other application. Now in reverse operation, that is solid oxide fuel cell operation, this will be supplied to the hydrogen will be supplied to the SOFC, that can generate the heat. Okay, so this is the heat, and that can generate also electricity. Okay, to the this controller, and it will go to the end user. So this controller is supplying excess power from the PV compared to end user, that will go to electrolyzer. Again, if you need more amount of power from the end user compared to PV, then this can supply to the controller in fuel cell operation. Okay, then here using the waste heat coming from this metal hydride, okay, that heat will be used in compressor or heat pump application. So as I said, the metal hydride can be used for various heat pumps or thermal machines. Okay, so we can use construct two metal hydrides, and we can generate either cold energy, okay, that is below 20 degrees or 50 degrees, okay, by supplying heat at 150 degrees centigrade or 100 degrees centigrade. So this is the kind of heat pump we can use to generate the cold energy, or we can also supply hot water at 90 degrees centigrade. So in this case, this is also similar to your trigeneration plant. Here we can generate electrical power as well as cold energy, as well as the heat, means medium temperature, low grade heat for space heating applications. Now, till now I have shown this some kind of my experience with the experimental systems. The similar kind of system you can see in German hybrid power plants. Okay, so this same kind of concept they have taken and they have installed in the Berlin airport project. Okay, you can see this is the hybrid power station cum car refueling station. Here what they have is they have the power generating systems. Those are like wind energy and solar energy. Okay, then they have an electrolyzer. Okay, then they have a hydrogen storage tank, and they have some CHP plant. Okay, now we see they have like 40 wind energy converters, and each one will be around 1.8 to 2.3 megawatt of this capacity of wind turbine, each wind turbine, and they have like a 500 kilowatt alkanic electrolyzer to generate hydrogen. The excess power coming from this wind energy. Okay, so this is supplied to the grid, and the excess power will go to the electrolyzer, and it can generate the hydrogen as well as heat. Okay, so this stored hydrogen can be supplied to the refueling station, that will be around 450 bar by using some compressor. Then this stored hydrogen can be used for CHP applications to generate again electricity to go to the grid. So this is what we have discussed previously, the same kind of the practical system. Okay, pilot plant you can see in the Berlin airport. Maybe you can Google it if you want to have more information about this project. So they use the same kind of concept, electrolyzer and fuel cell and hydrogen storage and refueling station. But here they have used like they have not used like reversible fuel cell, but they have used individual electrolyzer and fuel cell. So what is now the future? Both your hydrogen and electricity as the energy carrier for this future energy system. So we have CO2 free primary energy. Basically, these are coming from your hydraulic or renewable energy, solar energy, wind energy, biomass, other sources. It will generate both your hydrogen and electricity. This can be used for both transport applications. Okay. Then it will go to the users. Then we have a hydrogen means oxygen supply to the environment, and you will take oxygen to the when you are combusting the hydrogen in the fuel cell. Okay, so this is a cycle system without having any pollution. So here I think this is the future system. Both we have electricity as well as hydrogen as the energy carriers. Okay, because the storing electricity in the batteries is will like huge cost compared to storing hydrogen. That is the one of the drawback of storing electricity. So we can use electricity for transport applications, small applications, or power applications. Okay, then the hydrogen will come as a storage system for renewable energy power production. So this is again similar kind of system. You have electrolyzer and fuel cell, and you have a storage, so you can store the excess amount of energy from the PV cells. Again, here I'm showing one more practical plant in Utsira. It is in island of Norway. Okay, so here also they use the same kind of system. So this is around like 12 kilowatt fuel cell they're using. Okay, here, so they have some kind of electrolyzer. So because this is the island, so they want to have like a self sustainability without using the diesel. So they have some wind turbine. This will develop produce energy. Okay, that will be supplied to the users here. Whenever they have excess power, that will be go to electrolyzer. Similar way, they will store hydrogen, and if the energy coming from the wind energy is not sufficient to supply to the your users, then this fuel cell will generate the electricity, and it can supply to the small grid. Okay, and they have used some kind of battery to support this fluctuations coming from the wind energy as well as hydrogen energy. So this is one of the practical applications of this storage system. And here you can see Hyundai has manufactured some fuel cell cars. That is, initially they have manufactured Tuscan, then now the recent one is Nexo. The efficiency is improved from 55% to 60%, and the power also now they are going for 120 kilowatt. Okay, the range also you can go up to 6-10 kilometers for one brief wheel. Okay, these are the Hyundai's various buses. I think maybe you have seen recently some news. The Germany has started, they have done some pilot scale hydrogen prime. So the train is driving by hydrogen energy. Now, if we see what are the challenges of hydrogen economy, basically the production. So production, the hydrogen production cost has to reduce. And slowly now we are using kind of like gray hydrogen, like we are using like steam reforming, other gasification process to produce the hydrogen for various applications. Okay, but now we have to move towards the green hydrogen. Okay, either we can use electrolyzer operation or thermochemical splitting or photoelectricity based hydrogen production. The again the cost has to come down. Now it's cost is high compared to the battery with electrical energy, so that has to come down. Then for storage, again we need a kind of system that can meet all the requirements of DOE, as I explained before. Okay, So till now, there is no system to meet all our requirements of DOE targets. Maybe in future that may come. Then distribution, again, we have to create some kind of infrastructure, pipelines and all, similar to your oil and gas. Then utilizing system, we have to create the efficient way of using this hydrogen in various applications. So thank you. If you have any questions, I can answer.
Hello, thank you sir, thank you for your nice lecture sir. Sir, actually we have two queries in the chat box.
Just I will see.
Yes.
Oh, I cannot see
any query from the audience. Any queries from the audience? Any queries from the audience?
Hello. Good morning, sir.
Introduce yourself first. Audience.
Good morning, sir. Myself, Dr. Amar Kumar Das from Gift Engineering College, Bhubaneswar. Sir, my question is related to that waste heat recovery. Sir, you have highlighted that that waste heat recovery can be utilized for different refrigeration and air conditioning purpose. Sir, yes, my question is related to that. Sir, whether the fuel cell, what the heat will be recovered, is it be sustainable for large scale of this refrigeration or air conditioning, sir? Or up to some extent we can use at a process heat utilization?
No, if your system is like 500 kilowatt fuel cell, which are practically they are developing, so that heat, that huge amount of heat will become at 600 degrees centigrade if you consider the SOFC. So that heat can be used for various applications. Like as I shown, you can use like organic Rankine cycle, or you can use directly to vapor absorption cycle for like combination of like you will have like power as well as heating and cooling. You have the pressure system. Yeah, you can use practically this waste heat coming from the SOFC to the vapor absorption cycle.
Okay, sir. That means we need to design the cycle according to the assessment of the heat that will be generated, sir?
Yeah, so as per this temperature limits, you have to design your system. Like even if consider this ORC, and you have to select the fluid which is relevant to the temperature and waste heat you want to use from the ORC.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Hello. Sir, good morning. Sir, I am Dr. Narayan Gowda speaking from Centurion University of Technology Management, Odisha. Sir, you said that the metal hydride is one of the way to store the hydrogen. So in that you have used intermetallic compounds. So can you please tell me what are the intermetallic compounds we can use for the storage of hydrogen, or we can choose any kind of intermetallic compounds?
No, you can use a kind of like lanthanum, or you can use like a kind of materials like titanium. Nickel 5, you can use other titanium, iron, and nickel. There's so many combinations are there. So much research has done already on hydrogen storage.
Alkali metals are not generally used, sir?
Yeah, alkali metals also used, but here you have to see the our conditions, operating conditions. Okay. So these alkali metals and like they may have like different steps of hydrogen generation, means desorption.
Yes. Okay.
So, but thank if you see DOE targets, they may not meet with respect to the DOE targets.
Oh. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Good morning, sir. I am Dr. Kumar Gaurav from UPS Dehradun.
Yeah, good morning, sir.
Yeah, my question is, when we use metal hydrides for fueling the fuel cell, is there any time lag for the start of engine?
No, you don't have time lag. Once you supply the heat, it will generate. Even without supplying heat also, it will resorb initially.
Okay, because
so it can take the heat from metal itself, like self-cooling.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
I have a question. The metal hydride.
Introduce yourself.
Abhijit Bhattacharya from a private engineering college in West Bengal. I have a question that metal hydride can be heated from the ambient itself, or separate heat has to be supplied.
It's dependent upon the material, but if you use like lanthanum and all, then you can supply heat from the fuel cell, which is actually basically waste heat.
Okay.
Any other questions, queries? Any other query? Okay. If you have any query, you can drop a mail to Dr. Satish Sagar. It's a very good presentation delivered by Dr. Satish Sagar Bogila. I thank him very much on behalf of our department as well as our institute, NIT Roorkee. Thank you, Dr. Satya, for your.
Sir, thank you once again, sir, for this wonderful lecture.
Very inspiring.
Thank you once again for giving this opportunity, sir.
Very inspiring. And morning 8:30 to 10:30, people, they are very slow pickup. But yeah, you boosted up.
I can understand. Anyway, next session, Vasu. Very interesting topic.
Yeah. So I thank you once again for your wonderful.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you once again, sir.
Okay. So I'll stop. Participants can stay online, or you can join at 10:30. The next speaker will be Dr. Professor Sudhasudha Basu, Director CSIR, Indian Minerals and Materials Technology, Bhuvaneswar. So he'll speak on solid oxide fuel cell. So please stay online. Thank you.